Good morning, everybody, and welcome to church. Aren't we glad that we're all cosy and warm and we haven't needed to venture out today? So whatever room you are in, whatever device you are using, whatever part of the country you are Zooming from, you are very welcome. Just a few notices before we continue with our worship. First of all, to just remind you or let you know that because of the weather, we've sadly had to cancel outdoor church this morning. We didn't really fancy joining the ducks out there in the wet. Pat Gore's funeral is on Thursday, and we can join this by web link. And the details, the link for that is in the weekly letter. And I do hope that some of you will be able to join us as we remember Pat, give thanks for her life and all that she meant to us. And then, of course, our Christmas services start next Sunday. All the details are in the weekly letter. And I urge you, please do invite friends and family to join us to all or any of our Christmas services that are happening next Sunday. We have a fabulous nativity service with our children and young people. Oh yes, we don't let a thing like coronavirus stop us from having our nativity service. It's going to be very special, and I'm certainly looking forward to that. And then of course, next Sunday evening, we have our carol service. I hope you are all looking forward to those two events as much as I am. So we now turn to our Advent candle liturgy and the lighting of our Advent candle. And as I light, so Jeanette will say the prayer.
Our first candle is hope. Our second is peace. And today we light the third Advent calendar, the candle of joy. Oh God, too often we think joy is something big. A celebration or a concert can certainly bring us joy. Joy, just as easily and far more often, we can feel joy in a kind word, or we can see joy in a smile, or hear it in laughter. Help us to not overlook the simple joys that peek into our lives daily. This week in our Advent journey, open our eyes to the joy that surrounds us. Amen.
Thank you very much, Jeanette. I'm delighted to welcome our own Frieda to lead our worship this morning. We're both hoping that his internet connection will remain stable. Frieda, I hand over to you.
You're muted, Frieda.
So thank you again. Thank you for your welcome, Leslie. When I think back on last Sunday, that's the day when we celebrated Dan's baptism, that really fills me with joy. And so it's very appropriate that we should light the candle of joy this morning. It was such a moving service, and especially his testimony. I always feel hugely uplifted when somebody shares their testimony with us, because it encourages me when somebody stands up and says, I share your faith, I share your passion, your conviction. When it comes to the Christian faith, I stand with you and I'll walk with you. I can't think of much greater encouragement. So thank you, Dan, if you're here. I don't know if you have joined us this morning.
He is here.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. So continue to ask your questions, Dan. Never stop asking questions, however far along you are in your journey of faith. And now we we celebrate this third Sunday in Advent, and it's Advent is a time of preparation when we invite Jesus to come into our midst with his healing presence, healing in the widest sense of the word. So let us sing our first hymn, make way, for Christ the King in splendor arrives.
Make way, make way,
make way, make way,
for the King of
Kings,
for the King of Kings.
Make way,
make way,
make way,
make way,
for the King of
Kings,
for the King of Kings.
Make way, make way, for Christ the King in splendor arise. Fling wide the gates and welcome him into your lives. Make way, make way, for the King of Kings. Make way, make way, and let his kingdom in. He comes the broken hearts to heal, the prisoners to free. The deaf shall hear, the lame shall dance, the blind shall see.
And now let us pray. Our great and loving God, you are ever near, ever approachable, even out of our anxiety and fear. Ever understanding, you come into our turmoil, our doubt, our weakness and despair, with your peace. You encourage us so that we dare to speak your name and serve your purpose. We praise and honor you, your majesty beyond our reach, your fatherly love so tenderly humble. We praise you for your love and truth made known in the words of prophets, in your word made flesh in Jesus, in his dying and in his rising. We praise you forever. But Lord, when you come to us, our self-confidence cannot stand. Our superstition, our lies, our self-deceit crumble to dust before you. Our selfish exploitation of each other, our secret contempt for others, our vanity and self-righteousness are shown up in all their paltriness and filth. But why should we want to stand up to you when you humble yourself before us in our Lord Jesus Christ? So come, come again by your grace. Forgive us. Purify us. And lift us up to celebrate your restoring mercy and to stand in risen splendor with Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Apostle Paul overflows with joy and invites the Philippian Christians to share his joy, even though he is in prison awaiting his imminent execution and death. Where does he get this joy from? Well, in our first reading, which we will hear in a moment, we're given a clue. And there in that reading, he proclaims the four words, "The Lord is near." And I guess this is the secret to his joy. And Delith is now going to read us that first reading.
Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Delith. Paul's relationship with his Lord was so strong and alive that it was always present. It was his constant accompanist, because his joy did not depend on any exterior circumstances of his life. And I wonder if you reflect on it, if you can say that of yourself, especially in this time of pandemic. But before we turn to our second scripture reading, take a look at this image in front of you and ask yourself, what are signposts for? What is their purpose? For just a minute's reflection. The main theme for our service this morning is, again, John the Baptist, like last Sunday. So he's given two Sundays. Last Sunday, the emphasis was more on his baptism, baptizing people. Today, the emphasis is more on his witness. And Carrie is now going to read us our gospel reading.
This is from John chapter 1, verses 6 to 8, and then reading verses 19 to 28. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. Now this was John's testimony when the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. He did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Messiah." They asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Finally, they said, "Who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John replied in the words of Isaiah the prophet, "I am the voice of one calling in the wilderness. Make straight the way for the Lord." Now the Pharisees who had been sent questioned him, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" "I baptize with water," John replied, "but among you stands one you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie." This all happened at Bethany, on the other side of the Jordan, where John was baptizing.
If someone belittled or diminished our ministry or the service we provide, I expect we would go straight on the defensive and seek to assert ourselves if we're confident. If we're less confident, maybe we would get disheartened or even depressed. Not so John the Baptist. He lessened the importance of his own ministry when he referred to Jesus saying, "He must become greater, I must become less." So in a way, likening himself to a candle that gets consumed and reduced in size the longer and the more it shares its light. So within that kind of imagery, John the Baptist would be saying of Jesus, "He must wax," pun intended, "I must wane." So he obviously didn't take himself too seriously, understanding himself as a mere signpost to someone far greater than himself. And signposts, as we know, they don't have an intrinsic importance and significance in themselves. No one driving around in the countryside somewhere finding a signpost to point them in the right direction, they wouldn't get out of their car and examine the signpost, saying, "Oh, is this signpost made of oak or mahogany?" But who cares? The main thing is the function of the signpost. Everything else is secondary. And the function is to show the way, to point in the right direction. And signposts always point away from themselves. I mean, I don't think I would find a signpost anywhere in the world that would point to itself. That would be a failed signpost, or someone would have mucked around with it. Now, as a church, as the uniting church in Sketty, we provide multiple services, not only to each other, but to our community and beyond our community. It's quite staggering. The list, you only have to look at and read our church magazine to see there is one after the other listed there, the things we are involved in. And it's really impressive. And it feels good to be associated with a church like this. And if we provide such material and physical support and help to people in the community, people in need, then it could quite easily happen that we become popular in the community, which isn't a bad thing. And it could increase even our own feel-good factor, because it feels good when you're being needed, when you have a role, when you have a purpose. So that's a good thing. But it could also be that we draw people's attention and their, maybe even their admiration to ourselves, quite unintentionally. I mean, we all love to have positive feedback and appreciation and gratitude for what we do. I mean, we're all human. We all thrive on a bit of encouragement. But we cannot leave it there, because we are signposts. We are signposts called to point towards Jesus Christ, like John the Baptist. If we are waxing in importance and people only find their way to us, to our company, to our love and care, then, well, we will have provided a valuable service, but still not the full service we are called to carry out as a church. If we were just any charitable organization, that may well be our role, that may well be our full purpose, but we are the Church of Jesus Christ. So our terms of reference are far wider than that. When we provide physical and material help and support to people in need and left it at that, we still wouldn't have been the witnesses and the signposts we're called to be. We would have provided a service simply for an earthly kingdom, but not have pointed beyond that kingdom to the heavenly kingdom. Jesus Christ says in the Sermon on the Mount, "Let your light so shine before people that they may see your good works and praise who? You? No, your Father in heaven." And no other organization, no other charity, unless it's a Christian charitable organization, knows about that kingdom, about that heavenly kingdom, other than the church. The body of Christ, the people of God. We have been entrusted with the greatest message that's ever been around in this world. And it's not a, it's a message of great hope, of joy, of peace. And it's not just meant for us, as we know. It's meant for all the people, because Christ came for all the people. And we are the signposts to Christ, meant to lead people to a living faith in Jesus Christ, to do our part in that story. I mean, wouldn't it be wonderful? Wouldn't it be great if we had one testimony like Dan's last Sunday after another? How great an encouragement that would be to us all. Now, coming back again once more to John the Baptist, he was asked repeatedly by a number of various people about his identity. Who are you? Are you the Christ? Are you the Messiah? Are you Elijah, whom the Jews were expecting to appear before the Messiah appears? Are you the prophet? And to each of these suggestions and guesses, John the Baptist said an emphatic, "No, I am not. I am not." And from the negatives about himself, "I am not," he points towards the great positive "I am," to the one who said of himself equally emphatically, "I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the gate to the kingdom of God. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the true vine." John the Baptist was a clear signpost. And if Jesus introduces himself with those words, with those titles, then it's good for us to get a good grasp of what these titles mean, so that we can use them to point others to Jesus and to introduce Jesus to them, if he introduces himself to us through those titles. Now, in our first reading from the letter to the Philippians, we remember those four words, "The Lord is near." And these words chime with the words of John the Baptist when he says, "Among you stands one you do not know." He said that to the community of all those who were standing around. "Among you stands one you do not know." And in a way, he's saying this to our community around us. "Among you," mainly through the church, the body of Christ, "stands one you do not know." And it's essential that he will become known through us. We are the signposts, like John the Baptist. Now, the German painter Matthias Grünewald portrayed John the Baptist as with a very long index finger, as you can see, pointing out the direction the people have to travel in order to find life, life in all its fullness, eternal life. And as you reflect on the picture of this painting, I would like to invite you to also think about those I am words of Jesus. And think about which of those words you would find most helpful to use to introduce to someone you know the person of Jesus Christ. And not only to use one of those I am words, but also reflect on how you would put those words of Jesus into your own words, translated into your own language. We'll just leave a couple of minutes of silence and reflect on those words and that picture right next to it.
Thank you, Frieda, for sharing with us today. We have got something special that we are going to do now. We may have been, for the last 9 months or so, under some kind of restriction or lockdown, but as we know, that hasn't stopped us in UCS. And one of the things that we have been doing is that we've welcomed Adela's idea to use the church as a clothing bank for refugees and asylum seekers as part of her work with Unity and Diversity. And it was into this work that Linda Jones came up with the idea of Christmas bags, that as a church, we would seek to give as a gift a Christmas bag to every family, child, man and woman who are part of Unity and Diversity. Little did we know how it would take off. And we want to say a massive thank you to Linda for all the coordination that she has done. And thank you also to all of you, members of Uniting Church Sketty, who have so readily taken part. We were asked for 43 family bags, 5 bags for 50 single men, 15 single female, and 56 stockings or bags for children of various ages. And we've been overwhelmed by everybody's generosity. Of course, we must bear in mind what Frieda has been saying to us today, that we don't do this to point to ourselves, but we do it to point to the love of God, which we seek to share. These bags will be being delivered over the next 10 days or so by volunteers for Unity and Diversity, including our own Sandra Cuthill and Ian Glenn. But before they go, and now that you can see images, an image of the bags in our church, let us say a prayer over these bags. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, because you are our Father, that means we want to be sister and brother to all our neighbours, near and far. Father, we want to be more compassionate and kind to our brothers and sisters. Help us, we pray, to do so. We pray especially that these bags will bring some Christmas love and cheer into the lives of those who have fled situations that we cannot even imagine. May those who receive them know that they are loved by you and welcomed by us. Bless these bags, we pray, those who are a part of the giving and those who are part of the receiving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And now we come to our prayers of intercession, prayers when we share with God our concerns for people in need. There are more people than we can pack into these prayers, but they will be making a start, which we can then continue in our own homes. And now Pam is going to lead us in those prayers.
Let us pray. We pray for the church to be a beacon, directing everyone to Jesus Christ. We hope that our church building is bearing witness to him through our beautiful nativity windows with the shining star, and our church family showing his love through the Christmas bags. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who have lost all joy in living through the trials of the pandemic, especially those in care homes who have not been able to see their loved ones, for single parents who miss the support of their family members, and all those who live alone. And we pray for all those who have lost their jobs or businesses. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for governments across the world to be filled with wisdom and compassion in the pandemic, that they may work for justice and peace. Lord, we understand how difficult it must be to reach a balance between healthcare for the community and economic worries. Now that there is a vaccine available, we pray that it will be distributed fairly to all nations, rich and poor. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for any needs amongst our own congregation and community. We remember those who are in hospital or receiving treatment, especially Joan, Noel, Mike, Ivor, and baby Benjamin. We pray for them and also the family of Pat Gore as they attend her funeral on Thursday. Lord, may they feel the strength of your arms around them, supporting them, caring for them, and loving them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And now a moment of silent prayer to bring the thoughts of all our hearts to God. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. And now, in the language that you find comes easiest to you, let us pray together the prayer that our Lord Jesus Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And now, coming out of the witness of John the Baptist, let us sing together our second hymn, from Singing the Faith, number 437, When the Music Fades.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart.
What a timely song in the pandemic. When we go back to our church buildings, we're not supposed to sing. The music fades, all is stripped away, but we still worship. No one can take that away from us. We still worship. When the crosses are torn down from church buildings in China, the people still worship. So thank you very much today for the tech team working behind the scenes, again, making a smooth running of our worship possible. Thank you very much. We're very obliged to you. We close with a sentence by the songwriter Paul Oakley. It's all about you, Jesus. All this is for you. It's not about me, as if you should do things my way. You alone are God, and I surrender to your ways. And the blessing of God the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit be and remain with us all today and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Frieda, for leading us in our worship this morning. You've given us a tremendous amount to think about. Thank you very much. And now, as usual, in a moment or two, we'll go into our virtual coffee groups for those that are staying. I look forward to seeing all of you next week for our nativity service and then our carol service. God bless.